About 2 years later, on the first night of Sukkot, there was a monsoon. Such a monsoon that it's impossible to get anywhere near the sukkah. The kind of rain that you have to see to believe, where the whole city is flooded under several inches of water. At close to midnight, after everybody had gone, you couldn't get anywhere near the sukkah. It finally stopped, and we were able to go into the sukkah. But by this time, it was just my wife, myself, our Chayamushka, and our Menachem Mendel. The dripping schach was mixing with the tears from my eyes. Why was I crying? Well, our financial situation had become rather precarious, and the COVID, for various reasons, seemed rather elusive. At that stage, we were frustrated, fed up, and very lonely. We didn't foresee a very rosy future. As we stood in the sukkah just before Kiddush, I had a flash of inspiration. I realized that I had arrived at the moment where I was finally a genuine shliach. True, companies do send expats overseas, but they pay them a handsome salary with a hardship allowance. And yes, embassies send diplomats to live overseas, but they become big machers. All this kind of exaggerated respect. I didn't see any financial stability anymore, nor any prestige. And there is no question in my mind at that moment that if I was an expat or a diplomat, we would look for another job and leave ASAP. I realized if I was here from my career, I would write Milafonim Abaddikak Bangkok, previously chief rabbi of Bangkok, on my resume and go find a job in a normal country. A country where it doesn't cost $3 a minute to speak back home, where it doesn't take a day and a half to get back to New York, where the kids don't have to sleep under mosquito nets, and maybe I could even find a country where the traffic jams are not so bad, a place where driving is actually faster than walking, even if you don't get on a motorcycle or a tuk-tuk. But my wife and I both knew that we are not leaving, come what may. For what reason? Simply because we are shluchim. And shluchim are not motivated by personal careers, but by the mission of spreading Yiddishkeit that has been entrusted to them. That Sukkot evening ended up being extremely joyful, and the blessing of Shehechiyonu extremely meaningful, as we gave special thanks to Hashem for having arrived at that special moment, at the turning point of our shlichus. That night, we received the gift of truly becoming shluchim. Rabbi Avohu was a great Talmudic sage. In those days, every sage would have an assistant who would broadcast his words. There were no microphones, and as sages often have low voices, the student with the loudest voice would become the interpreter slash broadcaster. Once Rabbi Avohu's wife, the teacher's wife, goes out to the market and meets the wife of the broadcaster. And the wife of the broadcaster tells Rebbetzin Avohu like this: "You think it's your husband who's whispering the Talmudic lesson in my husband's ear? Ah, your husband, he's whispering gibberish, mishagas. It's my husband who's really teaching the lesson. My husband just bends down and pretends to listen to your husband because of the political connections your husband has." Well, as to be expected, Rebbetzin Avohu comes running home, and she tells her husband, "You gotta fire this guy immediately. He's a no-goodnik. He's a lowlife. He's trying to steal your position. Get rid of him." Rabbi Avohu listened to his wife, but he patiently replied, "My dear wife, why get heated up? What's the difference? Mini umine yiskales ilo'o. Between my efforts and his efforts jointly, the one above is praised." In other words, if you are dedicated to the mission, then what's important is getting the mission done, not who's getting the credit for it. In 1985, the Rebbe wrote a unique and rare tzettel, a note written in Hebrew, putting forth on paper in concise language the job description of a Chabad Rebbe. I'll read the first part in English. The Rebbe writes, "The position of Rebbe is first and foremost to lead and encourage Jews in the fulfillment of Torah and mitzvahs, starting with belief in Hashem an observance of Shulchan Aruch, the code of Jewish law, etc., and to show them a personal example of this unshakable commitment to Hashem to the point of sacrifice. And the Rebbe continues, La'achar zeh, bo'im chayov betur proti, ve'gam bozeh, yisoid sheloy lingoya klal, betafkidoy hakloli ve'ho'ichi. Only after this comes his personal life, and then only if it is not in conflict with his above-mentioned general and primary goal, unquote. To sum it up in one sentence, the key to our tomorrow is our constant striving to be true shluchim of our dear Rebbe. Tonight, at this Kinnus HaShluchim, we remind ourselves, Wumen steht und für wen wir steht, that we are and will continue to be shluchei Adonai to bring Mashiach Tzidkenu. L'chaim, Brider!